super discounts on merchandise. Massive sales on courses from Chessable. Chessable and Chess 24 bundles, with new deals appearing every day. Visit chess24.com/deals.
And queen takes f3. Oh, what is going on? Oh, this is going to be a fortress. I just don't see any hopes at all. This is very easy. Just rook back and forth.
Taking chess to the next level.
Wow. Wow.
Wow, yeah. Nothing else to say. Wow.
Creating the future of the sport. Introducing the Champions Chess Tour. 10 months, 10 tournaments. The world's best players online and on TV.
Take your chess to the next level with carefully selected collections featuring some of the best video series from Chess 24. Courses to own them forever, save up to 60%, or go premium and access all series while having all other privileges of premium membership. Learn more at chess24.com/deals.
Want to raise your chess to a new level? Challenge Yourself is an exclusive, innovative experience designed for Chess 24 Premium members. Train like a champ, with a unique set of lessons prepared by the coaches of the challengers. Boris Gelfand and co. will help you improve your chess. Play a champ. Play a grandmaster each day in Banter Blitz. Take advantage of this incredible opportunity from June 10th. Go premium and challenge yourself.
Hey, everybody. Today we're doing day one of Banter Blitz. I'm finally home from the States, which is excellent news. I kind of missed home by the end of that trip. But also, as usual, traveling eastwards is definitely a lot more difficult for me historically than traveling west, so I'm kind of fried. So I might be even slower than usual, but let's start playing and see how much I will actually get affected by wanting to sleep all the time. In other news, there is obviously... Hang on a second, I need to open some chats. That would be a good thing to do, probably. We'll start by playing the Sicilian, as I tend to do in most cases, and then we might switch to different openings later on. I will if there is something you particularly want to see, I can perhaps try to oblige, but it obviously, you know, this very much depends on what people play against me, so no promises, but I can make an attempt if there is a very serious demand for a particular opening. Why is shoveling is harder than West? It just is, and I don't think I'm the only one saying that. The way your sleep pattern gets broken in this direction, I think, breaks it harder, so to speak. I'm not entirely sure about the, you know, the nature of this phenomenon, but I'm definitely not the only one who's reporting this. I don't know. I've been playing, you know, the system quite a bit recently in these types of settings. I played it in the Premium Arena as well. And as I mentioned during Premium Arena, it's definitely one of the Nidorfs where it would absolutely, you know, be beneficial to actually know some theory, which I don't. But I will say that, you know, even if it works out for me, this is definitely a line of the Nidorf which you should be playing, you know, with great care, or perhaps not even playing at all with the black pieces. It's extremely risky, and maybe even go as far as to say that it's just mathematically incorrect. What's the point of delaying Bishop B7? I mean, you're sort of looking at the point of delaying Bishop B7 there. Wang Chess, I got to play Rook takes C3 very early on, which is extremely beneficial in a lot of positions, and definitely is beneficial here because there is a lot of pressure on the white king side, queen side, and also, as you see, my opponent is now having to, you know, go into some sort of full-on defense mode instead of trying to build something on the king side. Is this theory? No, this is not theory. Rook A7 is actually quite annoying here, and it is very possibly a good enough reason for me not to have taken on C3 as early as I did. There's probably a solution, but it's extremely annoying to even have to think. And I will have to think here because, yeah, there is no obvious solution. I guess I can just go Rook C7. We're not threatening Bishop takes C4. But after, let's say, Rook F1, my position is not as winning as I would like it to be. And if I postpone queen takes e3 check for a move, I suspect I would have been better off specifically against this counter idea. I don't know if knight g4 is that smart, but I kind of like the idea of distracting my opponent's queen mainly is what I'm doing here. I'm trying, the queen was positioned quite well on the e3 square, protecting the pawn on e4. Yeah, I completely missed queen e1. This is a very, very good shot by my opponent. I completely missed this move existed. I am not interested in trading queens, but queen c6 allows knight a5, trading other pieces, which is also extremely annoying. Yeah, this is a very, very big miss. And yeah, the position is now extremely unclear, whereas I'm pretty certain I was doing very, very well previously. I would like to play bishop takes e4 or knight takes e4, but I don't think either of those two moves work because I have weaknesses along the 7th rank. I think I have to play queen c6. But it's very, very unfortunate that I have to allow knight a5. And I don't really understand why my opponent would choose not to play knight a5 there. I keep on missing moves that attack my queen. This is really weird. Queen b6 is, you know, clearly suboptimal because the move that my opponent played exists. Okay, we will win now because the queen had to stay on this diagonal. But yeah, that was, considering how good my position was out of the opening there, that was not very clean. Let's see if more people can refute my Grunfeld. And then maybe we will start playing other openings. There was a request for Alekhine, but difficult to play the Alekhine against 1d4. So I'm going to have to postpone that idea. Yeah, let's try this. There's been some movement in this line. Some very, very strong players have played it. Recently, including, of course, Magnus in one of his World Cup games. This is a very critical line, and the point here is that, yeah, queen takes d4 is less of an issue, but after bishop takes d4, black is borderline forced into sacrificing some material. You're not really playing for a win there. Your pawn sacrifice after bishop takes d4 is really only ever going to be good enough to equalize, which is, you know, dampening my excitement about this line a little bit. But it is very difficult to find lines in almost any opening these days where black has legitimate winning chances without white assisting in some way. If you didn't play the Grunfeld, what would you play against 1d4 as your main opening? Some sort of a Slav / something mix. I used to play it very, very seriously. Like there was definitely a period in my career where the Slavs, specifically the Chebanenkos, were... I shared basically like about half of my games, I would guess, were the Slav and the other half were the Grunfelds. I think bishop takes e5 actually works here, followed by knight g5, check, knight takes e6, and b2, b4. But I don't think I'm losing there. I'm going to be slightly worse, but it's not a huge big deal, I think. Because I can include bishop takes f2 in a number of different versions. I think probably just playing it immediately is the way to go. And now maybe knight c6 or knight d7. Knight d7 is kind of boring. I want to give my opponent like some kind of a semblance of winning chances so that perhaps he could overpress. If we go knight d7, I think it invites bishop takes d7 a little bit too much. And after bishop takes d7, I would have absolutely no winning chances whatsoever. And here, I mean, it sounds a bit ridiculous because obviously in this endgame, I'm just legitimately slightly worse. But because the structure is less symmetrical, at least, you know, superficially, it feels to me that in a less symmetrical pawn structure, there is a larger scope for my opponent to go wrong. And as you can see, you know, the structure remains asymmetrical here, and we can start maybe, you know, pretending that there is some prospects. Although mainly I'm playing quicker, and I am hoping that some flagging at some point might, you know, come to my aid. But of course, this is, you know, a very, very equal position. It's very difficult to imagine how black can win a rook ending like this. Rook c4 was actually a lot better than the move I made because it would stop, well, not stop exactly, but You kind of need to have a check against king e3. Because then rook a5 check is a lot less annoying for us. But I will restate that, of course, there is no real expectation that black wins this rook ending. We're not even, you know, remotely better after something like king f3. I can maybe, you know, pretend for a little bit, but even pretending in a position like this is tricky. This is still very drawn after something like rook g8, although... Okay, now I'm becoming a little bit interested, honestly. It might still be a draw, but this is no longer... this is no longer a comfortable draw for my opponent. You have to make it. And this is just no longer a draw, because I'm just going to be two pawns up for... I can take this as well. Two pawns up for not very much. A game which I think more than anything else, you know, is a good advertisement for never offering draws in any kind of completely equal positions. But yeah, you should not be winning positions like this. So let's play one. Properly high rated challenge, and then I will try to play some of the lower rated ones. Predictions for India versus Russia for Olympiads. Going to be a very interesting match, I think. The format is quite interesting with the mixed lineups, and India playing, you know, with Vishu on board one is always going to be quite exciting. So in this position, there's... Actually, castles was a very, very poor choice here, as I now realize. You're supposed to take on d4 first, ask white to commit to a capture of some description, and go from there. And if you play knight c6 now, white definitely has options which you should not be giving them. Specifically d4, d5, because the pawns on c5 and c3 are still on the board, d4, d5 becomes a very, very interesting option for white in this position, followed by some gambits. I think bishop f4 is what they play there. d5, knight a5, bishop f4. And those positions are very risky for black, which is why on the previous move, instead of my castling, you're supposed to either take on d4 or play knight c6. In a situation where d5 is sort of heavily discouraged because bishop takes c3 is a check. But on the other hand, if you take on d4, there's a lot of options for white which result in very, very level positions. Even if we are worse here, it's going to be the kind of worse where play is quite double-edged, which I think is... something to look forward to. I don't think queen d3 was the main worry in this position, but it's also a very logical move, of course. e6 is one way to reply to this. You are kind of... You know, it's extremely important to have a good reply to d6 if you play e6 here. And I am currently unsure what that reply would be. Because if you can't, you know, attack the pawn on d6 properly and immediately, you might run into very, very serious trouble in these types of structures. It just goes for just go face is very good advice. But the issue with that is, it is my opponent, I think, that will be going face here, not me. And yeah, that's always less fun. Bishop f5, you just play e4. I don't think I should be provoking e4 in this position. I think e4 is very much part of what my opponent wants to do anyway, so losing a tempo to make him make that move seems kind of illogical to me. You can go e4 here, but after takes takes, then of course I will play bishop f5 without the pawn being able to come to e4. Bishop f5 becomes much more interesting. Bishop g5 is a move, but I think queen takes d5 is okay. I'm still mostly worried about d6. And I don't really have a good reply. We'll pretend that nothing much is happening here and that we can play sort of around that pawn on d6, but it's going to get quite ugly. My hope here is that, you know, it's one of those it has to get worse before it gets better type scenarios, but I suspect it's not. I suspect it's just a bad position all in all. I'm not very convinced by the last two moves my opponent has made, though. I think this is giving me a legitimate hope of stabilizing. And yeah, thanks very much for the raid, Dojo. We will play e5. I don't think allowing e5 is any good. But now we can try... Why did I allow bishop h3 exactly? We should not be allowing bishop h3 here. Yeah, so now we've managed to round up the pawn on d6. We can take it immediately next move, or we can maybe even spend some time on like rook f7, bishop f8 to take it in comfort. Yeah, I missed queen a3, which is a bit annoying. But I have decent replies to it. I can maybe even, yeah, do this, for instance, because it's a very, very strong fork that we are threatening with knight takes e4, and the pawn on d6 isn't really running very far. If I take on d6 here, he will take and play bishop d2, which is a bit meh. If I take on c4, there's queen b3, but we can go like rook f7 for now and keep... yeah, I missed that. I keep on missing reasonably simple things today, but it's sort of to be expected with my brain still nowhere near proper operating speed. Queen b3, my plan was to go b takes e5, but as I now realize, I missed bishop f1, and that is going to hurt quite a bit. That is like a proper full-sized oof right there. I just cannot make that move. I thought I would take on c5, and after the trades on c4, we can pick up the pawn on d6 later, and we're still fine. But I think bishop f1 borderline wins after b takes c5, so yeah, that wasn't really an option. Rook e2 is a kind of an interesting little move. I guess my opponent wants a4, but it feels kind of slow. Why not bishop takes e4? Yeah, I was kind of considering bishop takes e4, but it didn't feel optimal. And now we will... It may be a little bit awkward for my... Whoa, okay. That's a bit unexpected. I thought I might be a bit better after knight takes e4, but I still expected my opponent to play it. Is there any way for me to cause any kind of mayhem here? Who is the opponent? I'm not sure, but it's some kind of a strong player from Serbia. I think the country says Serbia. I think I looked it up at some point, but I don't remember. This is a good move. First of all, my opponent is protecting the back rank, and also after the eventual trades on c4, there's never going to be any kind of bishop b5 shenanigans with the rook gone from this diagonal. So I quite like this choice. I think we can do this and just sort of offer a draw. The resulting position is not terribly exciting. Yeah, I think I definitely had a better position at least at some point in this game, but I missed a couple of tactical things and my advantage evaporated. So as promised, I'll take some lower rated challenges for a bit. I did offer a draw. Yeah, I mean it's a four against four symmetrical, both in structure and in material. So there's really not very much play left, and I only really do, you know, my pathetic attempts at flagging when there's actual little time left for my opponent, and even then, not in completely symmetrical positions. So I feel like offering a draw there cannot be too much of a mistake. The flag is unconnected to where you are geographically. As far as I know, chess24 is not geolocked. So I can pretend to be from St. Kitts and Nevis without actually being anywhere near St. Kitts and Nevis, and or, you know, telling my VPN that I'm in St. Kitts and Nevis. This is a kind of a setup where I'm actually in no particular hurry to take on c6, even though I'm guessing my position is slightly better if I take on c6, but I feel like keeping this in reserve is quite okay, because if the bishop retreats, the knight on d4 is quite a beautiful piece, and we can start pushing for some e4, e5 plans, maybe even immediately. It was just important not to blunder bishop g4, which is why I spent a tempo on h3. I'm not sure what this king h8 move is all about. I have the option of taking on f6 here and ruining the structure, but I will have to trade a lot of pieces if I do that, and I don't really want to. Don't really want to trade pieces just yet. And this appears to be a more or less free pawn, which I will pick up for now. Yeah, I can take on c7, but once again, my preference here is for moves which don't trade the queens. Which is why I will be taking on c7 here, but not on the previous move, because I did not want to offer a queen trade to my opponent. Actually, maybe I shouldn't even have done it here, because as I now realize, rook b7 is a very, very annoying threat, which I do not even have a good answer to, somewhat surprisingly. I didn't appreciate just how difficult it will be in this position for me to deal with that rather simplistic threat. But I think knight b3 is good enough, just physically cutting off the rook from the b7 square. I do have to give up on c2 there. And I suspect I'm not even better really anymore, which I definitely was at some point. Yeah, this feels like black should have easily enough compensation for the pawn. Do you have any block openings where you don't prefer to play as white? I'm not entirely sure if I understand the question, but I don't play very many openings from both sides, actually. Like, I used to play more, but these days I play the Spanish from with both colors. I play some Sicilians with both colors, but not a lot else, honestly. If you don't count some occasional games where, you know, I fool around with white. But in terms of my full-blown repertoire, there's really not very many openings which I get to play with both colors. Yeah, this is actually a very good move. I think holding positions like this when the queens come off becomes easier, so I'll keep the queens on for now. It will go back to like e4 or f3 or somewhere, but what kind of a stupid move is that? Like, I don't have a good reply to bishop c6. I really am sort of half asleep, which is not helping my quality of play today. If my opponent is so insistent about trading queens, I guess we can trade queens and then just start pushing. But yeah, I mean, this is a good marshal. Once again, I will use the marshal description for something which is, you know, which definitely did not start off being a marshal here, but a kind of a typical endgame where black has the two bishops against a bishop and knight with an extra passed pawn on the other side of the board. I always kind of feel like those positions are spiritually Marshall Gambit. I'm making a decent amount of progress, but even a position like this, I don't think, well, okay, now we're winning, but if the bishop actually went somewhere, I think it would have been very difficult to win. This is such a strange decision by my opponent. This trade would have been kind of wrong, even if it didn't immediately lose the piece. And it does immediately lose the piece in this case. So I'm very confused as to why bishop takes b6 was played there. If you play something like bishop b5, I genuinely don't know if I'm even winning at all. Yeah, this is not how you play the marshal type openings, for sure. You do not trade one of your bishop pair unless you have a very, very good reason to. I will not accept a draw offer in this position. Just saying. Offering draws in positions like this will not be met with unqualified success in most cases. Yeah, let's not pre-move g6 here. That would be unnecessary. We take those, although, as I mentioned, I can't really move pieces on the board very much, but yeah, bishop takes b6 there was a very, very strange choice by my opponent, which I can't really endorse. Yeah, chess 24 is clearly, you know, venturing out into the variety streaming with the, you know, they're providing time on their channel to card gamers, for which we card gamers are infinitely grateful, of course, because it gives us an additional platform. But I don't know if it's a successful move long term. F3 in this position is a rare move, but a pretty decent one, if I remember correctly, because e5, knight b3, I'm not sure how comfortable that is. And if you play e6, those types of positions with like the English attack with bishop b3, queen d2, and long castles, it's actually a decent version of the English attack here. I'll play e5 just to see what happens. But I suspect that what actually happens here is that we don't equalize and we regret everything immediately. In particular, because even knight d5 immediately in this position seemed like a very, very decent option. But bishop e3 is not a mistake by any stretch. And the issue here is that this looks like a Nidorf, but instead of the move a7, a6, I've played knight c6. And while, you know, superficially it might seem like I've gained something in that interaction, what actually happens is that you kind of bitterly regret the fact that the knight is not on d7. In many cases, not here, but in many other cases, you would be, in general, I think, quite unhappy with the fact that the knight is not on d7. I could have gotten this endgame with the pawn on h7. I think including h5 is not stupid, but regardless, you're still slightly worse with black in all kinds of endgames like this. Not by much. Sveshnikov on Nidorf, I think both are extremely healthy right now, but for me personally, I've never tried the Sveshnikov with black. I don't think I would be a very good Sveshnikov player. And I have been, a decent Nidorf player in my youth. And I can still play the opening, although not as confidently as I would have been doing when I was like 20, 25. This is a good move. Yeah, I was wondering about it even on previous moves for my opponent. And here, bishop f5, knight e6 check is a very annoying threat. I have a feeling I'm supposed to take on c5. I can maybe wait for one more move and throw in king c7, trying to provoke c4. I don't know if provoke is the right word, because c4 is very much part of what white is generally trying to do in these positions, but I think I will need to play king c7 anyway, so I'm trying to make white commit to something that they wouldn't necessarily want to do here before I quite unhappily take on c5 anyway, because I don't think I can tolerate this knight for much longer. For instance, after bishop f5, I'm pretty sure that I'm supposed to take on c5, because of the two bishops I can give up for this knight, I think it's very obvious that giving up the dark squared bishop is much better for me than the light squared bishop. Is king c7 a normal move? I think you end up making that move anyway. So yeah, I would say it's pretty normal. And now we get to perhaps win some tempi because we've provoked bishop f5. I think I'll play h4 first. I could also start with g5, but I think playing h4 first, apart from, you know, not having to calculate g5, h2, h4 from my opponent, is just generally a more sound strategy. We want to play g5 next move, and then we have a decent bind on the king side, preventing our center from being blown up at any point with, let's say, f3, f4. Bishop e6 was also something I could consider, but I think keeping the bishop on the long diagonal is reasonable. And here I'm extremely tempted to do something which might look a little bit weird and play b6, b5, giving my opponent a protected passer on c5, But now it kind of, you know, I feel sort of at home here, because there is definitely some lines in the Grünfeld where you get this precise structure on the queen side. In particular, in the queen b3 Grünfeld, there are definitely lines in the Hungarian variation of the queen b3 where black plays a6, b5, and c5 later, where you get this exact structure, and also I think this exact material in many cases. I never understood why top players push pawns on the flanks in endgames. It might become weaknesses. No, you gain. I mean, the amount of space you gain is a lot more relevant. Also, in this particular case, like all of my kingside was very much interconnected. So I don't know in what world it would become a weakness. You gain space. You, as you see right now, you create potential for weakening your opponent's structure. Those things are generally just a lot more relevant than any kind of... I almost blundered bishop a5 check there. I was planning to go knight hg3 and then h2, but bishop a5 check is a little bit of a threat here, as I now realize. Yeah, this is a very decent game by my opponent. I'm still better. Not better than him, better in this position. I mean, I'm also maybe arguably better than him at chess, but that wasn't the point I was trying to make. I think rook takes d2 wins material here, which is kind of lucky for me. c6-c7 wasn't really bothering me very much. It was possible, but I don't think it was that great because I could play king b6. But yeah, it was definitely something my opponent could have tried. His position is fine, but I'm still Peter Swidler. Yeah, that's definitely the takeaway from this game, Dodgy. That's what we're going with. Okay, one more slightly low-rated challenge, and then we'll go back to picking some high-rated ones. I don't think there were any particular things people were asking for from the white pieces. And I don't think, like, after what Nepo has done to poor Alireza in the Norway Chess Armageddon, I don't think I should be, trying my hand at the King's Gambit until I actually buy the course and study the opening properly. Because that looked very impressive. And I don't think I can repeat it without some very hard knowledge. Maybe I can ask Jan for some cliff notes. I don't know why I'm supposed to be better here, honestly. I think probably I'm not supposed to be better is the answer to my indecision. And this is about as good as you get in the 2f4 Sicilian. And somehow I honestly wanted to play the Grand Prix, and then I, for some reason, decided to play the Grand Prix without including knight c3 on move 2. Which is, I would argue, not the prescribed way of playing the Grand Prix. I'm definitely not the only Russian who watches cricket, but we are, you know, select few. There's not many of us, and you should treasure us while supplies last. This is the first move I don't understand by my opponent in this entire game. I don't know what rook e8 is supposed to indicate. And it also gives me time to stabilize, stop knight d4, perhaps bring the bishop to b1, play e5, all the good things. I'm still not much better by any stretch, but rook e8 just feels like it's a straight up loss of tempo. Yeah, I did not see that coming, but maybe it's not that great because it's kind of awkward for my opponent to protect. You can still play f6, I suppose, but f6 is opening, like softening the structure a little bit, and maybe we can try something like knight h4. Yeah, you can also ignore it completely, but I will take on e5 quite happily, because black now has to either find a way to attack it to win it back, which is actually not that easy, or yeah, black can do something like this, allowing me to plan around it. I can also play e5, e6 right now, transposing into an endgame, which is quite good for me, but I kind of want more. I'm not sure there is more, though. I did point out that you are supposed to play knight c3 if you play the Grand Prix a bit earlier. Not seeing that e6 creates a threat of queen takes e7 was a little bit of a mistake by my opponent in the previous game, obviously. The endgame wouldn't have been much fun, but the game did not need to enter. To end the way it ended. Oof. I instantly regret everything. Is this even playable? I think it is, but I'm very interested in, like, after knight c3, can I even take on b2? After knight d2, can I even take on b2? I have all these questions, which I have absolutely no reply to. Does this lose? It shouldn't normally, right? But it's always kind of risky in these types of positions. There's always, even if my opponent decides not to try to punish me by force, and actually this move may have been a very, very big mistake, or maybe not just yet. But I have to start thinking about returning this queen to its rightful squares, because it might get trapped. Yeah, d6 was definitely a sensible option, but it felt to me like it maybe wasn't doing enough to counter potential advances my opponent can make in the center. I don't know. So part one of the plan we've completed. The king is now away from the center. We have reasonably stable setup in the center to not allow any immediate jumps, but we're so far behind in development here that I suspect white has perfect long-term compensation. Queen e2 is a little bit vague, though, because it sort of gives me additional tempi to create knight takes d4 threats. Although rook b1 probably solves that issue, yeah. See, that's really strange to me. I think I can take, right? I don't think I'm missing anything spectacular here. The game appears to have gone somewhat off the rail for my opponent here, because yeah, the pawn on b2 you can definitely claim not to care very much about, but the pawn on d4 you really are supposed to value that one. Yeah. Good position, which is only really threatened, as far as I can tell, by my feeling that I might need to insert matchsticks under my eyelids to keep my eyes open, which is a bit of an issue, considering we're supposed to be going out later today. This is an interesting move. If I take with the queen, it gets hit quite a lot with like rook c1, rook b1, and I can't get it to, let's say, d8, because queen b6, bishop c7 is a bit of a problem. We can take with the bishop, but that's also awkward. Yeah, Sam, I think, is also in Europe, right? So he is in a very similar boat. I don't know if I like queen a3 because rook ab1. This is kind of weird because I'm three pawns up, but despite the fact that I'm three pawns up, I'm not even sure I'm that much better. Very much reminds me of these French lines in the 92 French you occasionally encounter even now, where white's like spatial advantage and control over the important squares is just unbelievably strong sometimes. Knight b3, even here after knight b3, I think it's kind of awkward for me because I don't have great squares. But I mean, three pawns up is a lot, obviously, so I probably would have survived. Peter, I'm not liking his position, name a more iconic duo. Flat Tusk and Agam with a duo on the side is probably a more iconic duo. The word duo just kind of forced me to do that, right? The games not starting are not really helping me not fall asleep. That's very counterproductive right now. Ten, nine, eight, seven, six, five, four, three. And I'm not even white in this game, right? I'm not missing the fact that I'm supposed to make the first move. Yeah, at least it's not you forgetting to start. Yeah, I was going there myself, J-Beast. Yeah, my counting down skills are perhaps not what they used. Ban. I want a ban phase. I can do without the peak phase, but I want the ban phase. Not sure about b3 though, but I'm also not sure there is a good way to, you know, quote unquote, punish it. It's a move like any other. It's obviously not ideal for white to have to play b3 in these types of structures, but yeah, nothing of value has been lost. Yeah, clearly he saw the last game and decided to save the pawn. I think, yeah, that's a very fair description. We are actually slightly better with black here, which I think is obviously, you know, it's a very... E takes d4. Interesting. It's a very good outcome of the opening because, like, this specifically this structure is arguably, you know, the one structure where having the pawn on b3 is going to be a disadvantage for white. But you still have to prove you have anything at all here with black. And the knight on e5 provides reasonable compensation. I can play... There's all kinds of little fancy moves here. Like, even queen a6 is not entirely ridiculous. I'm trying to figure out if knight e5, g5, knight e7 is any good. But I'm worried I will not have much after c4. It's probably still my best option, though. Is the reply to London part of the Grunfeld course? I will have to cover the London in volume 2. So there will be something about the London there for sure, but it probably won't be specifically this. Queen a6 is becoming more and more interesting with every passing minute, but maybe we don't need to do it just yet. I kind of need the b6 square for the knight, though, to prevent c4 and just generally to land the knight on c4. How much do I care about the pawn on a7? Not very much, I don't think. Maybe I should be caring about it, though, yeah. Because of specifically one move in this position, yeah, not this move. Although this move is also not as bad as all that. This whole sequence has not been particularly well played by me, if we're honest with ourselves. But are we honest with ourselves? Should we be honest with ourselves? So many questions. It should be the reader should insert their favorite anti-London system. If I'm allowed to do that, I am definitely going to go with that for sure. Why would we start being honest with ourselves now? Yeah, exactly, Kawasa. We haven't been doing this for years and years, and it would be very weird to suddenly do it this very moment. Is rook c8 any good? No, it's not, right? Yeah, this just loses. I think my opponent kind of miscounted how quickly this pawn runs a little bit. Don't let me down. Hooray, it works. Why does black typically lose a pawn? I don't think black typically loses a pawn. I think out of, you know, the body of all the chess openings, if you take the chess openings as a whole, I think there's a lot more positions, I don't know, by move 15, which are equal material. You can play c6 here and transpose back to the course, or you can do many other things. We shall go with many other things. Even though this particular many other things is not really advised. Knight c3 is playable here, but actually playing e4 and d5 I think is smarter. Not that this is bad, but I think if you want to try to punish what I'm doing, you should be playing e4, g5, knight a5, queen e1. This is some kind of weird sideline, which I think exists, but I'm not sure what its current reputation is. There is also, after knight c3, there's a really weird move, bishop f5, which I think MVL has made once or twice. Maybe I should have done that for... variety's sake. I could try Nothing But Worried, but I'm not the world's biggest expert on... I mean, the Ruy Lopez I always considered myself to be reasonably in touch with that opening. I don't know if bishop e6 is optimal, because rook b1 followed by queen a4, or maybe even the immediate queen a4, is potentially quite annoying. I'm not sure about this move, though. Do I have to spend a tempo on rook b8? I think with white having played a4, the answer is probably no. And, you know, if I can get the rook to d8 in one tempo, it's probably stronger. I've also missed knight e5, and then the pawn on b7 would have been hanging. But I kind of salute my opponent for playing knight d2, because I think knight d2 is a lot more logical from a strategical point of view. And if you just make a conscious choice with white, never to calculate a move like knight takes e5 in a position like this, it will not be the worst idea in the world, because yes, you will be missing out on some spots where knight takes e5 might be strong, but strategically you will be making a very, very sound choice just to not to bother with moves which completely spoil your structure. I salute my opponent for making my life easier. Not exactly. It's one of those, well, yes, but actually no type situations. I don't know if I succeeded, but I was trying to make a kind of a more general point about these structures. We have come out ahead here. My opponent sort of failed to justify previous play by, you know, moving his pieces back and forth without really subscribing to any one. Yeah, I completely missed queen b, bishop b4. Yeah. Queen c3 was not very good. Pretty much any normal move in that position would have been stronger. We're still very much winning, though, in particular after bishop takes a5, I think, because I now have an outside passer, which will be extremely difficult for my opponent to deal with. A4 kind of allows b6, so we can try to be greedy and not even give that one opportunity to my opponent. It's not exactly like that, Vanitas. I did ask for people to sort of do opening requests. And this is not a lesson as such, but there's definitely, you would hope, some sort of a teaching element to what we're doing here. So yeah, that wasn't insulting or upsetting or anything. He was, whoa, okay, I did not expect that. I have no idea where this, I guess it's a pre-move. I was kind of wondering why rook takes a7 was played so quickly there. Okay. Do you ever play 1d4 with white? There was a period when I tried making 1d4 even maybe my main move, but I did not entirely succeed because I mean, 1d4 players arguably are slightly happier right now than 1e4 players in terms of like super early tournaments and just how difficult it is to get anywhere against the, you know, quote unquote meta. You know, meta openings people will play against you. I think the Berlin stands both better, and also it creates more sense of absolute universal dread compared to, I don't know, the Nimzo or the Queen's Gambit or, you know, anything. People can play against 1d4, Grunfeld included. Can you play Larekin? Yeah, it's been mentioned, but I don't think I've seen 1e4 in quite a while. People have been very d4 heavy against me today. I very much prefer open positions to closed ones, Sigma. This one isn't starting. As usual, we'll wait for a bit and then... Isn't Absolute Dread what you usually desire? No, no. Absolutely not. Dread is not my preferred emotion. Sorry about the sniffles. I have no idea why that is. Although there's actually quite a significant drop in average temperatures. It had been, you know, consistently plus 30 and up in St. Louis for the entirety of the 40 days I was there. And it's about plus 10 outside right now in St. Petersburg. And I did go outside today. Did not enjoy that very much. Is the Bishops of Vienna... Vienna probably not, but the Bishops opening it will transpose to the Italian in most cases. A lot of non-starters today. This is, I think, a third in about four opponents I picked in the last 10 minutes. Karakin won with Bishops opening today. Has he? Hang on. I'm very confused. I thought they haven't started yet. I thought the games start a bit later. In like an hour. Why are you trying to confuse me? Not fair. I'm very easily confused as is, so. He means yesterday. Yes, was that a bishop's opening? I thought it was something. It was. Yeah, I realize now I haven't actually looked at the opening moves at that game. I clicked on a random spot in the middle, and Jan seemed to be completely fine for most of the game, and then lost that queen ending, which I don't think absolutely had to lose. Let's put it like this. Have you ever played any tournaments in Italy? I played one or two, but not very many. Italy is a country I haven't actually visited too often on chess-related reasons. At some point, we had a streak of, I think, 3 or 4 years in a row where we spent our summer vacation in Italy, specifically on Sicily, which is very on-brand for a chess player, I guess. But I haven't really played much chess in Italy for whatever reason. We can't see your Hearthstone. Yeah, that's because nobody really wants to see my Hearthstone right now. Trust me, it's a very, very pitiful sight. I can play against the c5 pawn. Like knight a4 is actually quite strong right now. But yeah, I was trying to figure out if maybe I can play something on the king side, but with the king still on e8, I don't think I'm supposed to, you know, freak out and start to give, attempt to give some sort of an immediate mate. I don't think it would work anyway. Rook b1 is a bit, meh, but I kind of feel like maybe I will eventually need to play B2, B3. So it does make some limited amount of sense to play rook B1 just as a preparation for B3 in, let's say, this position. I'm not too sure that rook b1 b3 was the best I had. Maybe even knight takes c5 was playable, but I honestly just did not want to calculate. Yeah, c4 is possible in every single position here, including specifically. Yeah, I think I'll play c4. Just locking this down is generally a very good recipe in these types of positions. It stops c5, c4. It kills off the light squared bishop for my opponent very, very efficiently. And this is a blunder, actually. Or maybe it's not. I thought for a second that I blundered dc4, dc4, bishop takes c4. And I actually did it on the previous position, right? He could have done it here, which would have been quite strong. So yeah, I haven't really played this sequence particularly well. But I did make sure to calculate one line, and that line is d5, d4 here, which, I mean, knight takes a6 wins, but this is much more fun, taking on d4, and if queen takes c5, taking on e6. What's your favorite country to play a chess tournament? Hard to say. Holland has always been, or the Netherlands, I think, as you're really supposed to say these days, has always been a very, very pleasant experience for me in terms of sort of comfort and love and respect for the game. This kind of a combo is very, very good, but I don't know. I think in general, my answer would be, the list will be very similar to just the list of my favorite countries anyway. So, I mean, England would be quite high. We are completely winning here, of course, with all the threats we have along the dark squares. So we have time for two or three more, depending on how they go. Yeah, that was a... Yeah, I love playing the King's Gambit, says Blundering Beast. So people say it's kind of unsound. Yeah, I mean, as we've seen, Even at the Super Grandmaster level, against somebody who, for whatever reason, chose not to prepare specifically for the King's Gambit on the day, it's extremely playable even at that level. So you definitely do not need to be giving up on the King's Gambit for club level play. And... I suspect Jan recording a King's Gambit course was a little bit of a troll, considering he's playing the World Championship title match later the same year. So his choice of a subject there, I suspect, was at least somewhat influenced by his sense of humor and his feeling that specifically doing a King's Gambit course in 2021, with everything else going on in his life, would be quite funny. But I would still recommend his course to anybody who wants to take up the opening, because I don't think you just played. Yeah, that's a very weird statement, because, I mean, Fedorov played King's Gambit in every single white game. That name you got absolutely right. But I don't think Judit played. I mean, I want to say any, but any is probably an overstatement. But I genuinely don't remember here using the King's Gambit a ton. Yeah, this I don't think my opponent should have done this. This feels suboptimal, because now I no longer really have to worry about any kind of activity on the queen side. The queen side is effectively closed. And also giving up on this quote-unquote bell bishop on d7 for one of my knights is, I think, counterproductive in this particular structure. Do I have to care about bishop g5? Because there are ways for me to at least try to stop it, but I don't know if I care enough. This move looks kind of strange, but there's a specific reason for it. I want to be able to meet bishop g5 with queen d2, not allowing the queen to come to the king side. No, b3 is completely irrelevant. If my opponent somehow manages to play like b5, b4, even then I can more or less ignore it. And all of those things are incredibly slow. So I wouldn't really call it a thorn in my side at all. I'll play h6 check here, because I think my opponent wants to keep the files on the king side closed. And this way we probably open the h file, because I don't think black can manage without picking that pawn up. And now the rook on h1 will be doing something. Important not to blunder g5, g4 in some sort of a setting, but should be possible, right? Not 100% sure this was very clever, but it seemed like a good idea at the time. Because knight g8 followed by h6, yeah, this is a bit clunky, but knight g8 followed by h6 would have been quite annoying in the previous position. Now there's no time for it. Queen f8 was actually, you would argue, you know, actively counterproductive. Because you would want to play knight g8 now, but g5 is hanging. Would have been better with the queen on d8. I might midnight fox. It's not entirely clear if I will. So yeah, now the king side is starting to fall apart. I don't know if there was a stronger move, but I mean, this is definitely good enough, and it feels kind of unnecessary to look for anything stronger, because you sort of know that this will work, and I generally don't like looking for better solutions in positions where I can see that my original solution should win the game anyway. This is a good move I completely missed, but I am still winning material with queen h5 check. Because now after bishop g5 check, if the king runs away, I have queen takes g6 and rook takes h8. So you have to kind of play king g7 now, which drops the bishop on a7. Also completely losing, completely lost for black. So there's no good choices left anymore. Yeah, I could have taken on e7 without trading queens, but it doesn't matter. I guess a couple more is fine. Maybe even three, depending on how things go. My opponent deciding not to take up my e5 knight h5 gauntlet is disappointing. And d5 is not a good move here. I think you're supposed to play d6 and play the peards, but I'm in this kind of a mood. But yeah. Even after he takes d5, once again, I think e5 was probably much stronger, but even this is going to be slightly worse for black with no real prospects. So I'm not entirely sure why I was so excited about this opportunity. Some winters are cold, but generally I think the winters have been becoming... Tenses are difficult for me right now. It's getting milder and milder is what I'm trying to say. There's been a number of years in the last, I don't know, 5 to 10 years where we didn't even have snow on New Year's Eve, which would have been completely unthinkable when I was growing up. So, like, autumn-like weather on the 31st of December, you know, like -2 with, like, rain, this type of weather. Yeah, I haven't equalized here at all. It's a very annoying position. The bishop on c8 is a really, really stupid piece, which is why I like the move h3 so much in all these types of structures. I think you should be playing h3 as early as possible just to make sure that black cannot trade the bishop on c8 for the knight on f3. I really like my opponent's play so far in this game. They're making a lot of sense. I'm kind of busted after knight d4 in this position. Like, my position is just very, very bad. It's not even, you know, the kind of a, you know, typical Svidler doesn't like his position, but his position is completely fine type situation. This is one of those where Svidler doesn't like his position because he is objectively busted and is worried he might not make it to move 20 type situations. I have no idea what I'm supposed to even play here. I guess it's knight d7, but then I don't have the next move. I'm just completely stalemated. The bishop on c8 is still there. I don't know how I'm supposed to finish development. This is unbelievably bad. If only f5 was legal. Even f5, like, yes, king h7 and f5 is maybe the only proactive plan I have in this position. But even if that happens, I think my position improves ever so slightly, not by a great deal. And I would assume it's possible to generate enough immediate threats for me to never have a realistic chance of pushing f5. It's +0.95. It's +0.958, yeah, something like that. I will say that this feature, which is not at all exclusive to chess24, of course, yeah, I'm getting crushed because knight e4, actually, I think I lose a queen, or at least it gets very, very close to me losing a queen, which is maybe why I wasn't supposed to play queen d6, but if you don't play queen d6, what is, you know, what is your life? What are you, like, it's just, it's too sad for words. So we are now restricted to doing this and somehow hoping that knight f6 check is not immediate mate somehow, which it may not be. Anything north of +0.5 is resignable in Svidler's book. Not exactly, but... anything north of half a pawn is definitely, you know, start whining horribly, annoying all of your viewers type territory. Is queen d6 better or worse than queen c7 here? Is a surprisingly relevant question. I think queen c7 might be stronger. Because I might want... I mean, after knight takes f8, it probably doesn't make much difference, but I was also trying to calculate knight takes e5. And in knight takes e5 positions, there may have been some difference. It's either some sort of a weird cold or allergies or possibly both. Yeah, I appear to have been hit by a bad case of sniffles, and sniffles in general are extremely annoying, both for the person afflicted with them and for the person for people who are forced to listen to the person with sniffles. And I would like to take this opportunity to apologize wholeheartedly. I was actually planning to play 5v4 here. How stupid can you get? Would have been a good move too, if not for the fact that bishop takes d6 just wins on the spot. I would have played, but e4 rook takes e4 unfortunately kind of wins there. Which is why I didn't do it. I was hoping to sort of preserve the complexity of the position without committing to anything just yet, but it ended up being bad anyway. This is a kind of a weird move, but what I'm trying to do here is, if f3, f4 happens, we kind of resign, which is why I am trying to block the bishop on h2. But yeah, that sequence wasn't great. We did lock down the bishop on h2 quite successfully, but everything else just fell to pieces in the process, which is suboptimal. And I don't think I'm mating my opponent here either. Feels like this will be the first loss of today's stream. Yeah, queen c4, or honestly any square, but specifically queen c4, I guess. Okay. Yeah, I don't think I'm flagging anyone in this position. I got completely outplayed here. I did get some chances at some point, but yeah, this is a very nicely played game by Flittencourt, punishing my unreasonably fancy play in the opening and never really letting me back into the game. One last one then. Yeah, well played to my opponent. I almost, there was a small window in that game where it felt like I may have gotten away with it. I don't know if that was a misclick or not. Probably not. Yeah, I mean, that may have been a slightly early resignation for sure, FX streamer, but I don't think it's unreasonable. I honestly don't think you save very many from that position. I'm not sure if this is wise or not, because I am giving up a very nice square on c4 from my opponent's knight. But I'm also effectively killing off, I no longer really have to worry about anything happening on the queen side ever again with this structure. The structure you also, the reason I've done this so confidently and so quickly as well is that this setup you can sometimes get in some slow Spanishes. And it's pretty decent there. This is an interesting option, which I don't know what I think about it. I'm not sure I agree with my opponent's assumed assessment that this is so very good for white. After knight e3, it's not that easy for me to find squares, but I thought h5 followed by bishop h6 is a good starting point. Does Rapport play online chess? I assume he does, because everybody does, but clearly not as much as some of the other top players. And I don't know his username. It's been very enjoyable watching him play in Norway chess. It's very refreshing to I see somebody who, yeah, that's a move I was trying to calculate while I was talking, and it's very critical. Because whichever way I take here is a bit of a concession. This opens the C file. If you take with the A pawn, you get to, I mean, you allow expansion with A4, A5. And yeah, I don't think there was a particularly great option for me there. But I also don't think this is so horrible. We can go rook c8. I played king g7 so that I no longer... Yeah, I kind of assumed knight c4 wasn't very good in every single position. But looking at this now, I don't know why I was so forcefully inviting my opponent to make this move. Seems like a mistake. Are you happy for the return of Kraken in the candidates? It will be fun to watch him in the candidates. I don't know if happy is a... Yeah, I missed queen takes c4. This is annoying. I kind of assumed he has to take with the d pawn. That's a strange move. I think that was just a flat-out blunder, and now we are probably just winning. Because the white position actually collapses very quickly. I have queen d4 after everything comes off on c8. It feels like just a very, very bad miss by my very strong opponent. Because I think this is exactly who the username says it is. And this is a 26-plus player. Maybe at some point, maybe even close to 2700. Very strong Ukrainian player. Yeah, and this is the issue that we can also include the b-pawn in the game, and that effectively, I think, that was a bit of a blunder. I could have played more... it was actually okay. There is a tactical justification for what I'm doing. Although, I did not see this tactic when I played knight g4, but when the opposition is so winning... There is always, not always, but there is often a tactic which justifies your previous play. Of course, the point here being that if white takes on b2, I have queen c5 check, and then queen takes d6. Wasn't your knight hanging? It was, but then the b-pawn would cost white a full rook. Okay, so this recovers from my loss in the previous game, I think, and... it's a good high point to end the stream on, beating a very strong player with black. There's going to be another Banter Blitz tomorrow at the same time. And then there's going to be a bit of a break because, as are many other people, I'm going to Macedonia to play in the Euro clubs. But there might be some more streaming after I'm back from the Euro clubs. Card stream when? I don't know. I've only got like 3 days at home and with the banters and also the jet lag and my, you know, constant desire to just fall down where I stand and fall asleep. It's difficult to slot the card stream into my extremely busy schedule. But I will see you tomorrow for another 90 minutes of banter. So perhaps you could consider tuning in then. Cheers, everybody, and yeah, see you tomorrow. Do you have to be vaccinated to travel to Macedonia? You have to have a very recent negative PCR test. I'm also fully vaccinated, but I don't think European Union recognizes the Sputnik vaccine, so that's irrelevant. So yeah, see you tomorrow. Cheers, guys.
Want to raise your chess to a new level? Challenge Yourself is an exclusive, innovative experience designed for Chess24 Premium members. Train like a champ with a unique set of lessons prepared by the coaches of the challengers. Boris Gelfand and co. will help you improve your chess. Play a champ. Play a grandmaster each day in Banter Blitz. Take advantage of this incredible opportunity from June 10th. Go premium and challenge yourself.